Here we go. Philippians chapter 2. It says, therefore, or I'm sorry, 2:5. Let me help you. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5. Says, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus. And so now we are told how to think. And you go, okay, well, that's great, that's a verse, but what is this mind? What does it look like? How should I be? Where should I be at? And who am I? I mean, these are all kinds of questions that we want to answer if we're going to live Christ-like, if we're going to let the light of Jesus shine. We got to understand what that looks like. And so many of us, we say, oh, I'm a Christian, but we choose to be like the world when we go into the world situations. And guys, we shouldn't be that way, because what happens is you put your light out. And the truth is, with those people that you sin with, if you will, you will not reignite that light for a long time. Because when people look at you and you are living a sinful life, but you tell them, I go to church, I'm a Christian, I believe in Jesus, or if they sin, I love this, right? The Christian is sinning with them, but when they seem to go beyond the limit that the Christian's willing to go, they'll remind them about Jesus. Well, you just need salvation. You hypocrite, right? And that's what we have a tendency to do. Well, listen, what does it look like to be Christ, to have the mind of Christ, and where should we live this out? Well, go to 12. Philippians chapter 2, we're going to jump down to verse 12. And from 5 to 11, just real quick to catch you up so you don't think I'm just jumping way ahead. 5 says, let this mind be in you, which is also in Jesus Christ. Then from 6 to 11 tells us who Jesus Christ is. Tells us in a nutshell who he is, what he's done, and where he did it, which I find very interesting, because in 12 through 18, it does that with the application to us. So we see in 5 through 11, it was Jesus and the application to him, and then in 12 through 18, it is us and the application to us. I love that. I love how God says, okay, let's make it clear, now let's make it applicable or applicable. How many like applicable? How many like applicable? You guys, you will never hear applicable from me again. I go against the stream. And I will eat ice cream all year.
Amen.
There you go. yeah, whatever. Here we go, 12. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed. Therefore, what is therefore there for? We got to find out what it's there for. So therefore, because of who Jesus is, because of what Jesus has done that we see in 6 through 11, because of all of this, therefore, because Jesus set the way, Jesus is the King, Jesus is the Savior, Jesus showed us how to do it, now, therefore, we are to do that. Therefore, my beloved, who's he talking to? Us, the Christian, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence. He says, listen, you are the same people whether I'm there or I am not there. Wow, there's a testimony. Amen. I'll tell you, one of the greatest compliments that I have ever received was when somebody came up to me and they said, Pastor, here's the best thing. You, in 10 years that I have known you, because I've been in New York for 10 years now, in the 10 years that I have known you, you have never been any different from the day I met you. Whoa, I love that. I got a little excited, yeah. It'll be all right. Right? I love that. Why? Because you know what? I'm living it. Whether you are there or you are not there, I am the same person. Guys, if we will grab hold of that, and Paul says, listen, Philippian church, man, whether I'm there or I'm not there, you are honoring to God. Man, I love you for that. And guys, I think we need to pick up on this as well. Amen. Whether somebody sees you or they don't see you, you need to be the same. Whether you're in church or not in church, you need to be the same. Whether a Christian is around you or a lost person is around you, you need to be the same. I'd rather you be hot or cold, but not lukewarm. Isn't that what Revelation says? Why? Because lukewarm means you're riding the fence. Lukewarm means you're not committed for Jesus and you're not committed against Jesus, so we're just going to kind of ride the fence. Here's the problem. Satan owns the fence. And so when you're lukewarm, you're of no value to God. And you go, did you just say I was worthless? Hey, I didn't say that. I said you're of no value to God. Why did I say you're of no value to God? Because God said you're of no value to Him. If you're lukewarm. He said, listen, I'd rather you be cold against me or hot for me, because then at least if you're against me, I'm not worrying about you being a hypocrite and doing harm. And if you're for me, then hey, you're going to tell somebody about me because you're living it. But don't be lukewarm. Don't live like the devil and then talk like Jesus. That's what he says. And guys, we got, listen, this is a new year, new beginning. Man, I'm challenging you today to grab hold of this. I'm challenging you to look at the Word of God, to look at your life, and make sure that they mirror one another. And you go, how does that happen? Read. Come and learn. And then make a decision to apply. Now, here's the coolest thing. And Larry, I'm just going to bust your chops all day today because I love you. And you know that, right? So Larry's made this commitment to not eat ice cream. As crazy as that may be, he has made this commitment to do it. And do you know what will make him successful? Next verse. Can't even touch that. Oh, dude, I am so going to put X-Lax in your brownies. Like, how do you... Thank you, brother, for all the help you just gave me. You have just totally trashed my... I can't even go with you there anymore. All right, I'm leaving Larry alone. Therefore, my beloved, as you have always obeyed, not as in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. Work out your own salvation with fear and trembling. And listen, guys, when I studied this out, you know, before I used to think, and I'll tell you, I used to think, okay, it is work out your own salvation, what you're convicted of, then you stay away from or you follow, and what you're not convicted of. In other words, what you have freedom to do is yours. Have freedom to do it. What you don't have freedom to do, don't do it. But work out your own salvation. Not salvation as being saved, but because you are saved, you work that out. But here's actually what it literally means. And I was, as I was studying this out, and I came across I was studying out some commentaries, and literally the Greek word for work out literally means to finish the task. To finish the task. And I went, oh my goodness, does it really mean that? So then I had to go back to the Greek and make sure that the commentary, the guy that wrote the commentary, wasn't just pulling my leg, right? And you go, well, if he wrote it, he knew what he was talking about. Not always. You got to double check. Listen, I even challenge you guys, double check me. Listen, don't take my word for it. Study it out. And so I went back and I looked at it, and it literally means, if we go back and read this again in 12, it says, not only is in my presence only, but now much more in my absence, finish your task because you are saved with absolute reverence toward God. That's literally what that verse would say. And so as you look at that, Paul's not telling them, hey, work it out and figure it out. He's like, no, you got a job to do, and you've been doing it. Whether I'm there or I'm not there, you're doing the job, and so finish it. And finish strong. How many times have we heard Paul tell us to finish strong? Go into Hebrews, right? Hebrews chapter 12. We've got a great cloud of witnesses watching us. And so what are we to do? Finish the race. And so we're to finish. Finish the task that God has given us. And you say, well, God hasn't given me a task. That's not true. And I'm about to help you see the task that God has given you. So that therefore when you walk out of here, you will be without excuse. Say thank you, Pastor. Some of you appreciated it, some of you didn't. I get it. Because nothing worse than to point it out and then be held accountable. Oh, like I can't even get away from it now, right? There goes my excuse. It's kind of like ice cream and yogurt. What's the difference? He knows I love him, and so if you're visiting, we share the same haircut, therefore we're brothers. All right, here we go. Verse 13. He says, now remember, in 12 it says, finish the task, right? And then in 13, look at the encouragement. For it is God who works in you to finish the task for his good pleasure. Right? Are you seeing this now? Are you seeing like what it really means? And so now you can apply this? Listen, it's God that works in you to finish the task he has given you. If you go to 1 Thessalonians 5:4, don't go there for sake of time, but in 1 Thessalonians 5:4, it says literally, for he who called you will also do it. And so if God called you, he'll do it through you, right? I can do all things through Christ who what? Strengthens me, who empowers me, who gives me the ability. And so we see here where, as if we look in Hebrews, it's finish the task, finish the race. And then we see in Philippians, hey, listen, God's got a job for you. He's called you to do it. He'll empower you. He'll equip you. He'll prepare you. And he'll set you off to sail. But you got to be committed. You got to be committed. You can't listen. You can't be a halfway Christian, guys. I'm sorry, because that's lukewarm. That's on the fence. Satan owns the fence. And so, in 2017, are you committed? In 2017, are you absolutely committed to Christ, or is he just a comfort word like mashed potatoes are a comfort food? I'm telling you guys, you got to be committed. You got to be in this. Is it going to be easy? Nope. Do you know how many friends I lost when I started living for Christ? Listen, I went from friends all over down to two. And then even those two were like, whoo, man, I haven't enough of Jesus. I don't need to hear no more. Yeah, you do. You need saved. Man, you're a heathen. And they're like, who are you to tell me? I'm born again. Now I know. I'm just a heathen that's saved now. But you're still a heathen and you're going to hell. You need Jesus. And so how many people do you think hung around to hear that? Not a whole lot. Life went from a big party to, whoo, Lord, you better hold on to me because you're all I have now. Finish the task. Finish the task. Well, here's the thing. Who are we to be? Who are we to be and what task are we to finish? That's what I love about this passage. Look here as he says in 14. Do all things. First off, now he sets it up how we're to do it. How we are to do the task. Without complaining and disputing. Without grumbling. Without gossiping. I know nobody in here would do such a thing. Without complaining. Oh, I love this complaining thing because, you know, the truth is there are times where I'll go, hey, guys, I need help. And I'll go to people, individuals, and say, hey, man, can you help me do this? Can you help me do that? Of course, at the church. And all I hear is complaining about how they can't help God because their life's so busy. Well, if your life is so busy that you don't have time for God, your life is too busy. You need to back up. Your focus is on the wrong thing. You need to get rid. Just because the world says that you need to be going crazy to look busy, that's not true. Get dedicated to Christ. Do the things of God. Keep your focus where it's supposed to be. And they go, well, I'm too busy. And then people that say, yeah, I'm all in, Pastor, let's get it done. And then I get those who complain about how they did it. I'm like, shh, they stepped up. Where were you? Shh. Don't complain. Don't dispute. Don't cause problems. Listen, I don't need you to come in and tell us how to live for Jesus. I need you to come in and join us in living for Jesus. I was talking to a friend of mine who has a church, and he said we were talking because somebody had left his church, and I said, man, ironically, somebody left my church too. We're in good company. High five one another. And I said, why did they leave your church? And he said this. He said, well, this lady had been coming for about 4 or 5 weeks. And then at the end of one of the services, she came up to me and she said, Pastor, I want you to know I'm going to find another church. And he's like, can I ask why? That way we can fix it if it's from doing something wrong. Every time I've come here, all I hear is Jesus, Jesus, Jesus. I got up and gave him a hug. We were in the restaurant. I go, dude, the same thing. Right? Oh my goodness. Listen, we need, what else is there but Jesus? Amen? And so I told him, I go, listen, man, that's the biggest compliment you will ever receive in your life. Amen? So we need to be all about Jesus. And so we need to do it without complaining and without disputing. In verse 15, listen, just so that you guys know, some people will come to church and they go, well, you know, I've been going to church all my life and I don't remember one sermon. Well, thank you. That question was, or that statement was actually brought up, and a gentleman said this. How long have you been married? 32 years. Can you tell me every meal that your wife has ever prepared for you in 32 years? Well, no. But you're alive and healthy because of what you don't remember. Guys, I'm telling you, it's never a waste of time to come to the house of God with the people of God to hear the word of God. 2017, make it a point to be all about Jesus. Make it a point to do the things of God without complaining, without disputing. And then look at here. Why are we to do that? Look in verse 15. In verse 15 it says, that you may become blameless and harmless. You know, the Bible says that we are to be wise as serpents and harmless as doves. It says that we are to be kind to our enemy as heaping hot coals on their head. So they're under pressure and they feel bad for talking about you. That's that blameless. That when somebody talks about you, listen, there is no concern because you know that you're not guilty of what they're saying. There's no value in their words. It's of Satan and it's destructive. We are to be blameless. But I will tell you this, if you are living a life and hanging around people constantly that are not blameless and they're not harmless, I don't care what you might say, well, I'm trying to win them to Jesus. That's why I'm hanging out with them. Well, listen, you're not doing very well. Well, they're my friends. But here's the problem. You look like your friends. You don't look like Jesus. And so you need to quit hanging out with them. You need to be blameless. And you're like, well, I don't do what they do. Guilty by association. Shun the very appearance of evil. Isn't that what the Bible says? As a matter of fact, what did Joseph do when Potiphar's wife reached out to grab hold of his coat? He dropped his coat. He dropped everything and he ran away from that situation. He ran from that sin. And there's too many of us that take pleasure in joining other people thinking that Christians are stiff-necked. Listen, I don't know of anybody that has more fun as a Christian than I do. I'll just be quite honest with you. I love life. I enjoy life. Man, and I, listen, God said He gave me life that I can enjoy all things. And I do. Paul even said this. Paul said, I became all things to all men, that I might win some. And so we see that Paul had this freedom, this liberty to do things. But let's not forget what Paul was doing. When Paul said, I became all things to all men that I might win some, that doesn't mean that he went to drunks and started drinking with them so he could tell them about Jesus. It doesn't mean that when he went to a house of sin that he enjoyed that, whatever that sin is, that he could tell them about Jesus whenever that sin disappeared and the morning came and everything, the dust settled. What it meant was, he says, listen, if I go to the Jews, I'm not going to offend their culture. If I go to the Gentiles, I'm not going to offend their culture. But I'm going to stand for Jesus. And so if I go to the Jews and they don't eat bacon, I'm not going to have bacon. But if I go to the Gentiles and they have a BLT, I'm going to ask for extra strips. Right? That's literally, okay, maybe not asking for the bacon, but you get to my point. I'm not going to offend their culture because that's not what's important. What's important is that I remain the same everywhere I go. What's important is that I finish the task at hand. And what's important is that I remain blameless and harmless through the process. Well, then he goes on. Look here in 15. He says that you may be blameless and harmless. Who? children of God. Listen, you may be blameless and harmless children of God, that you may be the representation that God has made you to be and empowered you to be and called you to be and saved you to be. Children of God. Now listen, if you're not a child of God, it's real easy to figure this one out. If you say, I'm not too sure about who this, all this Jesus is. Oh, and how about this? All right, I believe in Jesus. Hold on, you're going to love this one. I believe in Jesus, but I have a real hard time believing the Bible. Save your spot in Philippians and quickly turn to John chapter 8. That would be to the left of Philippians. Now we're going back to Philippians, so don't lose it. John chapter 8. In John chapter 8, now here's the thing, guys. If you say, and listen, I'm just trying to help you identify who you are. I'm trying to help you identify whether you're a child of God or a child of Satan's. And you go, really? I'm one or the other? I'm not a child of Satan's. Listen, if you're not a child of God, you are a child of Satan's. I'm just saying that out loud. So here we go. John 8:47. In John 8:47, Jesus says this, He who is of God, he who is the children of God, a child of God's, hears God's words, believes the Bible. Right? Therefore, you do not hear, you do not believe the Bible, because you are not of God. Did that just get real simple or real scary? Think about that for a minute. In John 8:47, Jesus says this. And I'm just trying to help you clarify who you are. He who is of God hears God's words. Therefore, you do not hear because you are not of God. You're not God's child. Guys, I'm going to tell you, if you want to know if you're a child of God's, the question is, do you believe every word that is in this book? And if in your heart of hearts you say, I'm not too sure about every word, then you're not of God. Therefore, you're not saved. And you go, you can't judge me like that. I didn't judge you. Jesus did in John 8:47. You hear the difference? I'm not judging you. I'm not laying at your feet and saying that you're not a believer. What I'm telling you is that God said, if you don't believe every word of His, you're not His. Do we need to answer the phone? I'm just asking. Here we go. Go back to Philippians chapter 2. Philippians chapter 2, verse 15. That you may become blameless and harmless children of God without fault. Nobody can point at you and say, but you did. They can't do that. Without fault, where at? Where are we to do this? Where are we to do this? In the middle. That's midst. Literally means in the middle. Of a crooked and perverse generation. Where are we to do this? Where are we to live godly, to be godly, to act godly, to talk about Jesus, to look like Jesus, to act like Jesus? Everywhere you go. In the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. If people look at you and they don't see Jesus and there's no hint of Jesus in you or around you and there's nothing about you that screams, I love Jesus, I'm going to tell you what, you are not letting your light shine. You're not. And you say, well, I don't want to offend them. Oh, but we'll offend God. That's okay. I get it. After all, God can't see us. Forget the verse that says we stand before Him as naked. Meaning that you can't hide anything from Him is what it literally means. Well, if I offend them, they won't hear me the next time. No, but at least they heard you the first time. I'd rather give them a first than a never. Amen? I'm going to tell you guys, listen, man, when Paul's talking to the Philippian church about this, guys, we need to take it serious. We need to take our walk serious. We need to take our Christianity serious. And where do we need to take it serious at? In the middle of the crooked and perverse generation where people need to hear the gospel, because the truth is, had somebody not been bold enough to share the gospel with you or I, we'd be lost going to hell. The truth is, had somebody not stood up and said, "Thus says the word of God," we'd have no hope. And if we had no hope, man, what can we take in the fact that God works and does miracles? What hope do we have that we can't reach out or cry out to our Father who art in heaven? Lord, hear our cry, Lord, and touch our brother or sister in Christ and heal them. What hope do we have? We'd have none. What comfort to be. Listen, I'm going to tell you, there's people who are distraught because they have no answer, they have no hope, and nowhere to look. And then you take another person in the same situation that they're in, and they're just as calm as can be. They have this peace that we cannot explain. Where does that come from? Well, God tells us, "I'll give you the peace that passes all understanding." How can we have that peace if we have no hope? How can we have hope if we don't have Jesus? Guys, I'm telling you, man, when we're talking 2017, living this new life, and listen, the truth is, this might come as a shocker, but not everybody likes me. I'm just saying. Not everybody likes me. And you know why? Because I'm not set out to get them to like me. I'm set out to get them to love Jesus. My goal is not for them to go, "Oh, Pastor, I love you." My goal is to go, "Pastor, thank you for sharing the truth with me. I'd love for you to be my friend. I'd love for you to like me. I'd love for you to love me." But that's not my goal. My goal is not to set out to offend you. My goal is to tell you the word of God, to tell you the truth, so that you don't walk around ignorant, sabotaging your own soul. But that you hear truth, you see truth, the Holy Spirit has an opportunity to come in and grab you so that you can hear from God and receive Christ as your Savior and heaven as your home. I'm not on American Idol. I don't give a rip about popularity. I really don't. But I do care what happens to you. I care about your soul, and I carry you so deeply in my heart, and I pray for you continuously. And some of you are in school, you're teenagers, and you're struggling. You're like, "Oh my goodness, man, I got such a battle in school, and it's so hard." And man, I carry you in my heart. I'm telling you, I carry you so deep in my heart and pray for you every day, that you can stand strong in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. When you say, "I love Jesus," man, that you have the strength of God and the power of God on you and a hedge of protection to keep the world from beating you up and beating you down. Because I'm going to tell you, in the school today, it's almost hopeless. But you're the hope. You're it. You're it. Man, if I could walk beside you every day and be your bodyguard, I would. Listen, I'm not afraid poking somebody in the eye. I'll do it. And if they're real bad, I'll do a double poke. I have not seen anybody with a nose bigger than that gap right there. I can get both at the same time. All right, if I started at the peak, I might not sometimes. But you get what I'm saying. Guys, we have a task to do, a job to do, and it's going to be hard. Let's not play around, make it look like it's going to be cakewalking real easy, because it's not. As an adult, as a teenager, as a child, it's going to be hard. It's going to be tough. But you still have to make the decision, "I am going to do this no matter what. I'm going to stand for Christ. I am going to be blameless. I am going to be harmless. And I am going to do it in an area that nobody likes me. Because I love Jesus more than I care about what people have to say about me. Because I love your lost soul more than I care about what you have to say about me. In a crooked and perverse generation." Guys, do you realize that we right now have a generation coming up that 95% of them will never hear the gospel? And do you know why? Because somebody was afraid to offend them. I wonder when they're at the great white throne judgment. The great white throne judgment. That is where all people who rejected Jesus Christ stand and get judged and condemned and sentenced to hell. Final place, final stand, final word from God. And we're going to be there. Let me tell you something. The Bible says no more tears, no more sadness, but not until after the great white throne judgment. Which means that we're going to watch our loved ones and our children and our friends and our family. We're going to watch them be sentenced and cast into the lake of fire. We're going to witness that. And you go, Pastor, that's a heavy load. Somebody's got to tell you the truth. It's a heavier load to go through it. We need to stand before them. We need to share the gospel with them. We need to let our light shine. 2017, let it shine like never before. I'd rather stand before them today with them having an opportunity than to stand with them at the great white throne judgment, watch them be sentenced and cast into hell with no hope and no chance of changing their mind. Guys, that's a tough place to be. And you go, ah, no, that's reality. That's reality. You go, I don't believe it. You know the coolest thing about truth? It's not dependent upon you believing it. Truth is truth because it is what it is. Whether you believe it or not, whether you like it or not, whether you want to hear it or not, and whether you can process it or not. So in 15, he says that you may become blameless and harmless children of God without fault in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation among whom you shine as lights in the world. You need to be that light where the lost person is hurting and they see you and your walk is so great they walk up and go, I need to talk to you. Can you help me? Because what do you have? I want it. That's what he's talking about. That's what he's talking about. At your workplace, at your home, at your family functions. But then he goes on, 16. What are we to do when we're walking in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation? Look here in 16. Holding fast what? The word of life. Looky here. This is the word of life. Holding fast what we have read, what we have learned, what God has opened our eyes to, what he has given us. Holding fast the only thing that will ever deliver them from hell. Holding fast the only thing that will ever deliver them from the pain and the anguish of cancer, the pain and anguish of divorce, the pain and anguish of financial destruction, the pain and anguish of a child coming in and destroying your home, or of a parent coming in and destroying the home, the pain and anguish of having no hope, the pain and anguish of not knowing where to turn, the pain and anguish of what we have in the midst of a crooked and perverse generation. It is the word of God that delivers us from that. And he says, hold fast. Hold fast. Look here in 16, guys. Holding fast the word of life so that I may rejoice in the day of Christ, that I have not run in vain or labored in vain. Paul says, listen, I want to know that all the energy I poured into you, all the effort I poured into you was not a waste of time. And as a pastor, I feel like Paul. As a disciple, I hope you feel like Paul. As a parent, I hope you feel like Paul. That I have poured into, listen, in my children, whether they love me or they hate me, what they do from the time that they turn 18 and they move on with their life, I want to know that everything I poured into them, that I didn't do it in vain. That everything I poured into them gave them a solid foundation. Listen, Paul didn't go into these churches, even with Timothy, who was his child in the faith, right? His son in the faith. Paul didn't go into any relationship trying to win them with anything but truth. And they either submitted to the truth or they didn't. And Paul took the ones that submitted to the truth and he grew them and he nourished them and he encouraged them and he equipped them. And those who said, I don't want anything to do with it, they walked away. And Paul said, let me just put my effort where it's going to matter. And so sometimes, guys, that's what we're going to have to do. We're going to have to choose. We can't keep chasing down those who don't want to be chased. There was a movie out. I'm trying to think. I can't remember the name of the movie. Now, Catch Me If You Can. How many have ever seen that movie, Catch Me If You Can? Yeah, he would write counterfeit checks or whatever he did, right? And so it became a game of cat and mouse. And when the police officer, the detective, finally said, I'm not chasing you anymore, I'm done. That's when the robber came in and surrendered. He was only in it for the game. He was only in it for that, the thrill of the hunt, the thrill of, can I keep getting away with it? Can I keep? And then when the cat, if you will, when the detective said, I'm done, I'm not chasing after you anymore, he found no reason to keep running. The thief found no reason to keep doing what he was doing because the thrill is gone. And so, guys, if you have someone who just doesn't want to hear it, you just keep letting your light shine, but quit chasing them and put your effort towards something else. Quit wasting your energy and your time in areas and things and people that don't matter. And you say, there are people that don't matter. Even God gave them up to the reprobate minds. Even God said, that's what you want? It's yours. Go for it, baby. Okay, I used the term baby. I'm sure he didn't. You get what I'm saying, guys? Come on, get focused. 2017 is a time to get focused. To get focused on what's real and what's important. To get focused on the things of God, to be the light of God. Hey, if you need your batteries recharged, come to church. It's not a waste of time. Come to church. Listen, maybe you need saved. Well, admit you're lost. You got to start somewhere. Look here as he goes on. Verse 17. Yes, and if I am being poured out as a drink offering on the sacrifice and service of your faith, I am glad and rejoice with you all for the same reason you also be glad and rejoice with me. Guys, listen. Paul said, if I'm being offered as a drink offering, sacrificed on the altar, then so be it. You're going to feel like you're a sacrifice on the altar. And sometimes you're going to wonder why you're doing what you're doing and if it's just an absolute waste of time. And you're going to ask yourself, why do I keep doing this? Because you know it's the right thing to do. Why do I stay in this? Because God said, let your light shine. I'm tired. Hey, I will empower you. I will equip you. We're without excuse. And the truth is, we have all the reason in the world. And the reason is because we love Jesus Christ. And if you don't love Jesus, well, then you don't have a reason to let your light shine. If you don't love Jesus more than yourself, you'll never let your light shine. If you don't love Jesus more than offending someone, you'll never let your light shine. If you don't love Jesus more than the things of the world, you're never going to let your light shine. You're always going to compromise. You're always going to put yourself in a position you shouldn't be. And you're always going to expect somebody to forgive you. And the truth is, God will. Man depends. But God will only for a certain amount of time. He's long-suffering, but that window closes. And it's a different time for each person. We don't know who it is or when it is. But understand, God will close that window of being long-suffering with you. 2017. Guys, I encourage you to make this the best year ever. And it's not because of what you've done. It's because of what you've allowed Christ to do through you. 2017. You know, I look and I've done, in the last 2 months, I've done, I don't know, what, 7, 8 funerals? Last 2 months? Somewhere around there? People in the church, people out of the church. And here's one thing I'm assured of, and more so now, your life is but a vapor. We're here for a little time, we vanish away, and we don't know who and we don't know when. I've watched 24-year-olds die, 44-year-olds die, and 84-year-olds die. Death is no respecter of person. And in 2017, it's not going to be any different. People are going to die every day. And I pray it's not the person you've been ignoring forever. I pray it's not you if you don't know Jesus Christ. Today's the day to make a decision, a commitment. I want every head bowed, every eye closed, if you would. I want you to look into your heart. I want you to look deep into your heart. And here's the first question I want you to ask yourself. Listen, I don't know, and neither does the person sitting next to you. We don't know the truth of the answer to your question. Only you know your heart, and here's the question. Do I really believe what the Bible says? Do I really believe the very Word of God? And if you say, somewhat, or if you say no, then I'm going to tell you, you do not know Jesus Christ as your personal Savior. And therefore, your destiny, as sad as it is to say, is hell. I'm not judging you. I'm telling you what Jesus said. And if you want to change that, there's only one way, and the way is Jesus Christ. And if you say, hey, I believe that Jesus Christ died on the cross for my sins. I believe that he died and he was buried and he rose on the third day. He conquered death and hell and he's at the right hand of the Father. I believe it. I don't understand it all, but I believe that. The Bible says if you believe that, then you are saved. For with the heart man believes unto righteousness, and with the mouth confession is made unto salvation. And so if you're here today and you say, I believe it, and today I surrender to that truth, Jesus, I'm giving you my life, and I believe that you're my Savior because I believe your word. If that is you today, and today, for the first time, listen, for the first time, if you've been saved for years, I'm not asking you to raise your hand. But if today you said, today I've made a decision for Jesus, today I believe, then I want you to pray a prayer with me, quietly in your heart. Dear Lord Jesus, today I surrender. Today I am yours. Today I invite you into my life to take over. Today I repent of all the wrong I've ever done. And I believe that you'll forgive me because your word says you'll forgive me. Today empower me to be the light that shines in a crooked and perverse generation. Every head bowed and every eye closed. If you just prayed and believed on Jesus Christ, listen, the words don't save you. It's the fact that you believe on Jesus that saves you. I just take you through the prayer so that you have a time stamp that you can say, this was the day that I consciously made a decision for Jesus Christ. If that's you, will you just raise your hand so I can rejoice with you? Amen. Anybody else? Today I ask Jesus to be my Savior. Today I surrendered. I'm not going to fight it anymore. I'm not going to put it off anymore. Today I surrender. Anyone else? If you're here today and you say, Pastor, I've taken my light and I've hidden it under the bed, under the basket, under the rocks, in a closet and closed the door. I've not been living for Jesus like I should. But today, I'm going to make a conscious decision to change that and let the light of Jesus shine through 2017. If that is you, would you raise your hand so I can pray for you? Amen. Dear Heavenly Father, Lord, we come before you. Lord, for those who raised their hand for salvation, Lord, I pray that you would touch them, that you would bless them. Lord, you would strengthen them and encourage them. Lord, that you would keep them under your word, Lord, in your house, so that they can continue to grow, that they can go from babes on the milk to, Lord, adults on the meat. Lord, so that they can have the strength and the intestinal fortitude to stand for you. And so, Lord, use us as a body of believers, Lord, as a church, as a family, to nurture, to raise, and to grow those, Lord, who have made a decision for you. And Lord, for those who have said, today I make a decision, a conscious decision, to be committed to live for Jesus everywhere I go, Lord, I pray that you would empower them, Lord, that you would allow them to see amazing things that only you can do. And Lord, that it would continue to encourage them and then continue to strengthen them so they would continue to want to see your blessing in those great, miraculous lives that you have changed. Lord, for those who really aren't sure where they stand today, Lord, they're not going to raise their hand for salvation. Lord, they're not going to raise their hand to be committed to serving you in 2017, no matter the circumstance. Lord, I pray that you would send the Holy Spirit, Lord, to absolutely crush their heart, to absolutely squeeze everything out of them, Lord, that is hindering them from surrendering to you or serving you. Lord, that you would squeeze their heart so heavy, Lord, that it would feel like they can't breathe. Lord, it would feel like death is imminent if they don't decide for you. Lord, I pray right now that you would do that. Lord, so they would live for you. They would honor you, Lord. They wouldn't die and go to hell, Lord, but they would have life and life everlasting. So, Lord, please, please, Lord, touch those who want to decide for you, but, Lord, who have not mustered the courage to make that decision. Lord, please don't let them leave here without deciding today. So in Jesus' name I pray, amen.
We at Connecting Point Church are excited to have you join us. When you come, you'll experience a friendly, lively, and casual family-like atmosphere that welcomes you as you are. Our messages combine straightforward biblical truths, humor, and life-changing challenges for you to learn and grow in God's Word. We believe in connecting people to Christ, to the plans and gifts He has for them, and with people in our community who share these values. We also believe in reaching out to our local area and the regions beyond. We're dedicated to being a place where your entire family can believe, belong, and become all that God intends you to be. Discover the abundance of life in Jesus Christ as you begin to understand the roots of the problems and learn to apply the tools for you to triumph over your challenges today. It'll be a breath of fresh air in this unsettled world.